Hey guys, welcome to Engels and Essage, where we learn things maths and science. And today's topic is the importance of showing full working out whenever you're doing a maths problem, a chemistry problem, or a physics problem, or any sort of mathematical thing you got to do, whether it's for school or if you're doing this in real life or, you know, everyday stuff. And I know, it's such a drag to do all this extra sort of working on paper and writing and scribbling, and it slows you down. And you might think that it's much better if you do sort of take some shortcuts here so you can get more practice done within the hour. You can get to your exam faster. And you might think that's better. But you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot because there are a lot of consequences to doing things by cutting corners. And I'm hoping that I can convince you in this video about four reasons why you should do things in full working out. I'm also going to then talk about, at the end of this video, about how sometimes, especially if this is the first time you're doing high school mathematics, sometimes the ways you did things in primary school, it might have been okay for the kinds of maths work that you did then, but I'm having to bring you some bad news, is that you may need to adopt a new way of setting out because the primary school way may not be able to scale as you go through grade 7, grade 8, grade 9, grade 10, and 11 mathematics. As the problems require more work, the way you do it in primary school is probably not going to work. So I'll show you what I would like my year 7s to start off with, and then I'm also going to show you what I don't want to see, and I'm also going to show you what things look like when you're sort of much further up the road in mathematics. All right, so my four reasons why you should do things in full working on the page. One is that you can check yourself much more effectively, especially if you've done a problem that requires multiple steps. It's so much easier than trying to do it all in your head several times over. Second, other people can check your work, and that's super important for multiple reasons, but I'll get to them later. Next is that your teacher or whoever's grading your exam or assignment, they can actually see your working and thinking and like, oh yes, they can do multiplication, they can do division, they can do the things in the right order. They're applying the rule because I can see it on the page. If they don't see anything on the page besides the final result, they can't tick all the boxes, which means you don't get the full grades. Last one is that as you get older, the math problems that you do tend to require a few more steps, and also the problems that you do are much more important. Like, it can be life and death whether you get the answer right or not. You kind of want to make sure it's right, and you kind of want other people to be able to tell, like, to check your work, especially if there's a lot of money involved or people's lives are at stake. So let's say you're an engineer and you're going to build a bridge. If you did the math wrong and your bridge isn't as strong as you said it was, then that thing could break, people could die. Ugh, such a mess. Lawsuits, everything. If you're a business owner and you can't calculate how to pay your employees properly, let's say you pay them too much, that costs you money. Let's say you don't pay them enough, that's gonna make them angry. Let's say you're also a business owner and you need to get some supplies in and you did the math wrong and you didn't get enough, your business is screwed. If you're an employee and your boss says, I want you to do this and this and this, and you did some calculations, says, yep, this is the answer, and you're wrong, your boss is going to be mad. So you want to make sure that you're able to do maths in such a way there that is it's easy as possible for other people to be able to collaborate and check your work so that you have the best chances of things not going wrong. All right, so I'm now going to move on to showing you the kind of setting out that I'm looking for, particularly for my year sevens. As you go to grade 8 and grade 9 and 10 and so on, obviously you're not going to have to do a lot of this sort of rigid structure. But for now, year sevens, we want to go with the whole bells and whistles of structure. Only when you get further in life can you sort of take them off. Think of it like training wheels when you're riding a bike. Okay, I've got a problem from the book. I set out the question. I like to put them in a different color, or I like to sort of section it off, you know, sort of signpost that this is the problem I'm working on. This side here, I'm going to do my working. If I have to do any sort of side calculations, and I can sort of neatly tuck it away from the main line by line solving. All right, here we go. I'm going to do some rules. I'm going to use the BUMDAS rule, which means I have to do division first. I'm going to tackle this bit of the problem here first. So division, so I want to find out 60 divided by 3, which means how many times does 3 fit into 60? Well, 3 fits into 6 twice. 3 fits into 0, 0 times. So the answer is 20. So this new line is 18 divided by 9 plus 20. Now I do the BUMDAS rule again, and that means I have to do 18 divided by 9. So that means how many times does 9 fit into 18? So if you know your 9 times tables, that answer is going to be 2. So now the problem becomes 2 plus 20, and then I can just simplify that down to the answer of 22. That's the sort of line by line by line working I'm looking for. You can see I did the problem in 3 stages. This is what makes the system I'm trying to advocate here, the thing I'm trying to convince you of. If you do things this way, as the problem requires more steps, you just take more lines. Okay, it's nice and neat. Yes, it feels like you're doing a lot more pointless extra writing, but trust me, it saves you, especially when things get really hard. Now, what I don't want to see, so I'm going to show you an example of what I don't want to see. I don't want you to give me an exam or an assignment where I have question equals 22. Really? You could have guessed that. Lucky guess. 0 marks. Well, I don't know if it's 0 marks, but if your teacher's looking for, are you applying the rule? Can you multiply? Are you doing things the right order? Are you lots of these sort of things. There's no evidence on this page right now that you know what you're doing. No evidence that you did the problem in the right order. No evidence whether you guessed that luckily or not. You need to convey as much as you can on paper. When you're applying a rule, write the rule, and then you can keep going. Try and make it as literal as possible so that there's no question that the person who comes to read this, there's no question about, what is that? Where is he going with that? Where did that number come from? There should be no question about what you're thinking and what you're doing. Okay, that sets you up for success. Now I'm going to show you, I hope I don't freak you out too much. I'm now going to show you what it looks like when you get older. So here's a math problem that I would encounter. I think I did stuff like this in grade 12 maths B. I definitely encountered it again at university. So I did a chemistry and mathematics degree. So this is the type of problem that's way into the future. Now, I don't want you to overwhelm you. Don't worry about the fancy symbols and the numbers that go in the different corners or the letters. Don't worry, okay? Just push it out of your mind. What you should be focusing on as I do this problem is I want you to take note of how complicated the thing is, meaning it requires lots of little steps to do it, okay? And each step is not that, if you know what the rules are, the steps aren't that hard, but it does take quite a few steps sometimes. And there's no way you can solve this in your head. And I'm gonna show you. Here we go. Oh, I've done the problem before in advance, not because I don't know how to do the problem. It's just that I don't want to waste your time on video by going, oh, what's 3 times 2? That's the reason why I've got it here, just in case if I sort of need to double check. All right, so the answer is equal to integral of 6 on 3x3 minus 4 on 2x squared plus 2x plus c, 1 and 3. Okay, let's simplify this. That comes 2x3 minus 2x squared plus 2x plus c. Which means there's 1, that's what you get again. I've got 2, right, 1, 3 minus 2, minus 2 plus 2 plus c. Okay, there I'm done. So here you can see that it actually took me quite a number of sort of little steps for me to finally come to my answer. And this is why the system that I showed you just previously, this is what makes it so scalable. So I did the same sort of presentation as I did in this problem, where I had line by line as I go through lots of steps. When you get to stuff that requires a few more steps, you just add more lines down below. Now, this looks hard, it's not that bad. You'll be taught how to do this in grade 11 or 12 if you choose to take a maths to a more advanced level, but it's not that bad. So I hope That doesn't freak you out. That's not the point. The point is that it scales. I hope at the end of this video now that I've convinced you that you should be doing full working out, and the setting out you use is super important, because it can either get in your way or it can allow you to get more advanced in maths in the years to come. I think that's it for this video, and I will catch you in the next one. If you like the video, I'd love to hear some feedback. So thumbs up is wonderful. Comments down below is great. If something's confusing, you can leave a comment down below. I'll see you guys later. Bye.